U svojoj knjizi Sivi vuk, bekstvo Adolfa Hitlera, dvojica britanskih publicista odbacuju zvaničnu verziju Führerove smrti po kojoj se on ubio u svom bunkeru u Berlinu 30. aprila 1945. a Braunova počinila samoubistvo. Umjesto toga, oni tvrde da postoje brojni dokazi koje su oni prikupljali više od 5 godina, a koji ukazuju na to da je na kraju Drugog svjetskog rata ovaj par pobegao iz Berlina da bi iznova započeo život u enklavi pod kontrolom nacista u fašističkoj Argentini. Hitler je lagodno i srećno živeo sve do 1962. godine i čak izrodio potomstvo. U podzemnom bunkeru u Berlinu 30. aprila 1945. pred najazdom pobedonosne sovjetske crvene armije, Hitlerovi verni saradnici su ubili njihove dvojnike dobrovoljce, podoficira Wehrmachta i jednu glumicu treće klase. I Hitler je sa Evom 3 dana ranije u potaji izašao iz bunkera i ukrcao se u avion koji je sleteo u grad Tonder. Par je potom menjao razna prevozna sredstva i na kraju se u Španiji ukrcao u podmornicu koja ih je odvela do obala Argentine, gde su stigli upravo u trenucima kada su ubijeni njihovi dvojnici. Knjiga koja je u Velikoj Britaniji odmah postala bestseller nazvana je po pseudonimu vođe Rajha, Sivi Vuk, koji mu je još 1943. u svom planu za evakuaciju nadenuo najbliži saradnik Martin Bormann. Bormann je sastavio plan dislokacije najvišeg nacističkog rukovodstva iz Nemačke u Južnu Ameriku u slučaju da se ratna sreća okrene protiv Berlina. Planom su do najsitnijih detalja predviđene maršrute bekstva za svakog ponaosob, kao i sijaset drugih detalja. Saučesnici u tom bekstvu bili su američki obaveštajci kako bi zauzvrat došli do ratne tehnologije koju su nacisti razvijeli i do tvorca nemačkog raketnog programa Wernera von Brauna. On je verno služio Hitleru, ali je po propasti Trećeg Rajha osnovao američki kosmički program i rukovodio njime. Gerard Williams, istoričar i novinar koji je iscrpno pisao o Drugom svjetskom ratu, godinama je radio za britanske TV stanice BBC i Sky News. Snimajući seriju dokumentaraca u Argentini, naišao je na priču o Adolfu Hitleru. Tada se upoznao i razgovarao sa mnogo ljudi koji su bili sigurni da je Hitler pobegao iz Nemačke i da je živeo u njihovoj zemlji. Odlučio je da se udruži sa svojim starim prijateljem, piscem, snimateljem i fotografom, specijalizovanim za vojnu istoriju Simonom Dunstanom, a ono što su otkrili, obojicu ih je prenerazilo. Postoji daleko više dokaza o bekstvu vođe Rajha nego o njegovoj smrti. Knjigu Sivi Vuk objavila je izdavačka kuća Admiral Books. Šta vas je potaklo da napišete knjigu Sivi Vuk i da li vam je za to bilo potrebno puno hrabrosti?
I was in Argentina doing documentaries on a whole range of other subjects, on the economics of Argentina at the time and the veterans of the Falklands Malvinas War, the war between Britain and Argentina back in 82. And I came across this story that Adolf Hitler had escaped to Argentina on a submarine. And I thought, I've never in 30-odd years as a journalist ever done a silly conspiracy theory film, and this sounds perfect. So I was going to stop being a serious journalist, and I was going to make a silly film about Hitler escaping to Argentina. And then we started to look at the information, and we started to look at the fact that there was no forensic evidence from the bunker. And I got my co-author Simon Dunstan, who's a military historian, involved, and we realized that the story that we had been told, the original story that Hitler had killed himself in the bunker, along with Eva Braun, was simply not true. It was simply a lie. And we had information that showed that he had actually escaped and lived in Argentina after the war.
Poznato je da ste veliki poznavalac Drugog svjetskog rata. Čime ste se rukovodili u svojim istraživanjima i kako ste dolazili do dokumentacije za građu ove knjige, budući da to i nije bilo tako lako?
We found our sources from many sources, from the archives at Kew in London, which are the National Archives of Great Britain, from documents that are available online from the FBI and the CIA in America, from researchers in America, especially in Boston, who were working on our behalf. We employed a team of researchers in Argentina as well. I'd been to Argentina 14 times over the period of researching this story, and Simon has been 4 or 5 times with me and around me. All the information that is contained in Grey Wolf is out there and available for people. What amazes me is that the reports from the time, from 1945, reports from the BBC, reports from the Associated Press, reports from Reuters, AP, UPI, have all been ignored by historians, and yet this information is all there. What we've done in CiviVuk, in Grey Wolf, is to bring all this information together, and it tells a completely different story to the one that we've all been taught as history. There is a compelling amount of information here. Eyewitnesses that I've interviewed, eyewitnesses that we have tape recordings of, videotape recordings of, that show time and time again that Adolf Hitler, his wife Eva, and their 2 daughters lived in Argentina after the war. Instead of dying in a bunker in 1945, Hitler actually died near San Carlos de Bariloche in the Andes on the 13th of February 1962 at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, attended by his personal doctor, Dr. Otto Lehmann. The testimonies of these witnesses, nobody has been paid any money. Many of them have been just wanting to get it off their chest, tell the story finally. And frighteningly, 2 of our witnesses in Argentina have been threatened with death. They've had death threats for talking to us. Why would anybody want to threaten people in their 80s with death if they weren't telling something that other people didn't want to be told?
Postoji li neki podatak, nova informacija, koja vas je posebno iznenadila, šokirala tokom istraživanja?
I think the whole thing is shocking. There is so much information to show that there was collusion between sections of American intelligence and American business and the Nazis from before the war, and then from 1943 until 1945, while the Nazis were planning to escape. They knew the war was over. They knew they were finished in Europe. But while they were planning to escape, they planned with American friends. And it was with that American help that they were able to flee to Argentina. We're not just talking about senior Nazis like Hitler, Martin Bormann, Gestapo Müller. We're talking about over 100,000 European fascists. Ustashi, the whole of the Ustashi cabinet from Croatia at the time. Belgian fascists, Scandinavian fascists, French fascists, all fled out of Europe down the Italian Vatican ratlines with the help of the Catholic Church, the help of Juan Perón from Argentina, and horribly, the help of the International Committee for the Red Cross. These are all organizations that we are supposed to, the Red Cross and the Catholic Church, we are supposed to respect them. What has shocked me most is that these people are simply not respectable and are not worthy of our respect.
Zanimljivo je da je vaša knjiga CiviVuk s jedne strane doživala sudbinu svetskog bestsellera, a opet s druge strane je dočekala i tišina. Kako objašnjavate ćutanje javnosti kada je vaša knjiga u pitanju?
The book is available at the moment in 22 countries, so it is getting a lot of international exposure. It may be a bestseller, but Simon and I haven't made a penny out of this yet. And we have spent a lot of money, both making the film and for all the research. It costs money to go to Argentina 14 times and to stay there and travel the country. Historians seem to be very scared of looking at our information. I think what they like to do is they like to quote other historians. The problem with that is if the first historian got the story wrong, which in this case, Hugh Trevor Roper, the man who wrote The Last Days of Hitler, got it totally wrong. Nobody is willing to say, if you're a historian, that this eminent historian was wrong. Well, I will say it. I'm a journalist. I've been a journalist a long time. I don't just go back to one source. I go back and look at every available piece of evidence, some of which you just dismiss because they're not true. But there is so much evidence in this book, and it's referenced and it's researched properly, that historians need to take a look at this. This is a story that needs telling. And there are so many different aspects of this that change the way we look at the end of World War II. The Nazis did not disappear. They just took off their Hugo Boss uniforms and put on their Hugo Boss suits. But they stayed in power. They ran West Germany after the war. They stole so much money from Europe. $100 billion went with them when they disappeared, through the Swiss banks, who will do anything for 6%, went to Argentina and then went back into Germany at the end of the war, after the war, which helped rebuild Germany. The West German economic miracle was not a miracle. It was built on the money the Nazis had stolen from Yugoslavia, from Poland, from France, from everywhere they touched. So it's a story that needs looking at again, because this is a part of our history that shapes modern Europe. It shapes the modern world. And it's important that we know really what happened, not what somebody wants us to think.
Psihološki profil Adolfa Hitlera nam je uglavnom poznat. Kako vi vidite sivog vuka? Ko je zapravo sivi vuk?
I don't really do psychological profiles. Again, I'm a journalist. I deal in facts. I don't make things up. I've never met Adolf Hitler. If I'd met Adolf Hitler, like I've met many other people, presidents and leaders and warlords, then I'd have a view on it. What I do know is that this man led the most evil criminal regime of the 20th century. I don't know what was in his mind, but I do know that he was just a man, an evil man, but just a man. And I cannot see why the senior Nazis would want to give up, why they would want to kill themselves, when they had so much money, so much power left, and the Americans wanted help against the Soviet Union. And there's a saying in Serbia, there's a saying everywhere, the enemy of my enemy is my friend. And that, I think, is why the Americans and the Nazis became friendly, is because they had a bigger enemy, which was the communists and the Soviet Union. But what was in Hitler's mind? What was his psychological profile? I have no idea.
Promovišući sivog vuka, družite se sa vašim čitaocima širom sveta. Šta je to što vas najčešće pitaju i kakve su reakcije vaših čitalaca?
It's funny. People are split right down the middle. Some people accept our evidence and say, okay, well, this tells a different side of history to the one that we're used to. Other people dismiss it totally. We have had people say we were 2,000% wrong, but they haven't read the book. We've had other people who've read the book who have tried to destroy it bit by bit. If that's what they want to do, they have to come up with some real proof that Hitler died in the bunker. There is no proof. The Russians always said they had part of his head, part of his skull. But that was DNA tested 3 years ago. It's a woman's skull. It's not even that of a man. So it cannot be Hitler. They say they have his jawbone. But if the jawbone came from the same head as the skull, it cannot be Hitler's jawbone. All I would say is prove me wrong. Because we believe we have proved the official history very wrong. So now it is time that the official historians show me that my eyewitnesses are lying, that J. Edgar Hoover never went looking for them, that Stalin never said he had escaped to Spain or Argentina, and that Eisenhower in the 1950s said, we have no idea what happened to Adolf Hitler. So with all that weight of evidence, people have to show me that my eyewitnesses are lying and that the facts and the details are made up. Nothing is made up in this book. Nothing.
Uskoro će publika u Srbiji kao i širom sveta biti u prilici da vidi film koji je rađen prema vašem scenariju. Ispričajte nam nešto o vašem radu na filmu.
The film is based very much on the eyewitness stories in Argentina, the detailed testimony we have from people who saw Hitler and Martin Bormann after the war. It was all shot in Argentina with a complete Argentine cast. They're great actors. I hope that the film will be presented at the Berlin Film Festival in February. We still have to wait confirmation on that. But it will be on general release next year. And I hope it will be seen in Serbia. I hope it will be seen here in the Serbian language. And we're working on that now with our friends at Admiral Books to see whether we can make that work next year. The film is a dramatization. It's not a documentary as such. So actors play the parts of the witnesses and the situations that Hitler was seen in. The film ends with the words, we were lied to. And we were. We were lied to.
Da li je Hitler pobedio?
No, I think Nazism lost. The Nazis lost World War II. In some ways, Germany has benefited from it, but I'm not accusing modern Germany of anything. The Nazis lost the war, but they didn't lose it in the way that we have been told that they lost it. There was no real denazification in Germany. People just carried on. They needed them. They were organizers. They were the people in charge. And under the Adenauer government in the 1940s, His most senior security advisor had been the number two or number three at the Jewish resettlement office with Adolf Eichmann. These people were, I don't know why we let them get away with it, but I don't also know why. Maybe we should have killed many more of them. Maybe that would have been good. Maybe it would have been bad. But I think the Allies at least seemed to be on the moral side of right. At least we beat the Nazis, at least when I'm not living in the Nazi Europe. But there are lessons from that time. There are lessons from the end of the war and the history that is real from the end of the war that do impact on modern Europe today.
Radi promocije svoje knjige proveli ste nekoliko dana u Srbiji. Kako je vaše iskustvo sa čitaocima sa ovog podneblja?
I lived in Serbia. I lived in Belgrade 18 years ago, during the worst time in Yugoslavia's modern history. I loved Belgrade then, and I have many, many Serbian friends. It has been wonderful to come back to Belgrade. It has been wonderful to work with Admiral Books. They are incredibly professional, very friendly, lovely people. It's great to see Sivivuk in Serbian. The audience is here. The Serbian people who've been buying and reading the book have been delightful, asking good questions, asking intelligent questions, and I look forward to the reaction of people once they have read the book. Serbia has had a very open mind about this story, and that's important. You need an open mind for this. There are other countries which haven't been so open-minded about it. But it's a story that needs telling, and the more it is told, the more people will question the official history. Hvala lepo.
Knjiga Sivi Vuk, izdanje, dakle, kuće, to je Admiral Books, autori ove knjige Simon Dunstan i Gerard Williams, dva istaknuta britanska novinara i istoričara. Knjiga koja govori o tome da Adolf Hitler i njegova žena Eva Braun nisu skončali svoj život u bunkeru u Berlinu, nego da su pobegli tajnim kanalima u Argentinu, gde je Hitler živio sve do 1962. godine. Dakle, ovo je jedna senzacionalna knjiga koja je prošle godine u Engleskoj bila bestseller. Evo sad je prvi put na srpskom govornom području. Admiral Books je tu knjigu objavio i izazvala je veliko interesovanje čitalaca. Meni, da priznam, kada sam čuo da postoji ta knjiga koja govori o Hitlerovom begu iz Berlina, opkoljenog Berlina u Argentinu, mislio sam da je to neka vrsta science fiction priče gde su autori hteli na brzinu da zarade pare. Međutim, kad sam pročitao ovu knjigu, kad sam vidio sve fotografije, dokumente, zatim obilje podataka, faktografiju koja stoji iza ove knjige, mogu vam reći da sam se duboko zamislio, više nisam ni u što siguran. Pogotovo što je 20. i 21. vek zapravo vek zavera, mi smo na sopstvenoj koži imali priliku da osjetimo šta znače falsifikati istorije, a drugi svjetski rat je pun takih falsifikata od recimo japanskog napada na Pearl Harbor, pa do razno raznih operacija, iskrcavanja lažnog u Normandiji, igre oko Pade Kalea i tako dalje. Dakle, istorija 20. veka je još uvijek neistražena potpuno i ako se pokaže da je Adolf Hitler zaista nestao u Argentini i otišao iz opkoljenog Berlina, bit će to najveća prevara prošlog veka. Ono što u ovoj knjizi zaslužuje pažnju, kažem, pre svega su vrlo egzaktni podaci. Dakle, do sad se smatralo da se fragment lobanje Adolfa Hitlera krije, odnosno da ga čuva KGB centrala u Moskvi. Ovdje autori knjige dokazuju da je prema DNK analizama ustanovljeno da taj fragment lobanje ne pripada muškarcu, nego ženi koja je mlađa od 40 godina, a pri tome nije Eva Braun. Zatim, tu su detalji ne samo Hitlerovih zadnjih dana, nego zapravo jedna biografija Hitlera od njegovog dolaska na vlast preko izgradnje Trećeg Rajha sa kompletnim opisima celokupne nomenklature Trećeg Rajha i ono što je pri tome najznačajnije, a to je kako su zgrtali bogatstvo. Adolf Hitler je na kraju Drugog svjetskog rata bio enormno bogat čovjek. Dakle, svaka razglednica, svaka poštanska marka, svaki plakat sa njegovim likom njemu je donosio određene tantijeme. O svemu tome brinuo se Martin Bormann, koji je bio siva eminencija Trećeg Rajha, vrlo poverljiva ličnost Adolfa Hitlera, koji, prema autorima ove knjige, je i organizovao bek Hitlera u Argentinu. Dakle, kad govorimo o novcima, a kriminalisti, policajci kažu ako hoćete doći do zločinca, sledite trag novca. Trag novca Nemačkog Trećeg Rajha ide u Argentinu. Nemačke podmornice su iskrcale tone i tone zlatnih poluga u Argentinu. Argentina je na početku Drugog svjetskog rata imala nešto oko 300 tona zlata, rezervi, da bi na kraju Drugog svjetskog rata imala skoro 1000 tona zlata. Pitanje je kako je za 4 godine toliko naraslo zlatno bogatstvo Argentine. Naravno, nacisti su na vreme transportovali. Nacistički Rajh je bio super organizovana i precizno uređena država u kojoj su i novinari, i lekari, i doktori, dakle i profesori, i političari, i privrednici, svi dobijali, i radnici, i oficiri, vojnici, dobijali plate svakog prvog mjesecu, sve do kraja Drugog svjetskog rata, čak i u aprilu 1945. godine. Takva država da se porazi i da izgubi Drugi svjetski rat, a da nema opciju za preživljavanje i nastavak života njihovih glavnih aktera, malo je nelogično. Dakle, Nemci su sigurno znali da posle bitke kod Staljingrada ratna sreća polako prelazi na drugu stranu. I pretpostavljamo sa velikom dozom verovatnoće da su glavni likovi Trećeg Rajha već tada pravili plan odstupnice za život posle propasti Trećeg Rajha. Argentina sa svojim nepreglednim prostranstvima Patagoniji, sa 3 miliona Nemaca koji su živjeli u to vreme u Argentini, sa dakle, jednom logistikom koja je fenomenalna za skrivanje daleko od svih znatiželjnih očiju, bila je naprosto idealni kutak sveta gde su se nacističke glavešine mogle da skloni. Tu je na kraju i završio i Eichmann, tu se on sklonio, pa tu je bio i Pavelić, Mengele je umro u Brazilu. Dakle, cijela Južna Amerika je bila idealno područje za skrivanje glavnih likova Trećeg Rajha. Tako da postoji, kažem, sasvim logično ako je Hitler hteo da preživi, da može da se skloni samo tamo gde ima potpuno zaštićen mir i daleko od svih, ajde da kažemo, znatiželjnih pogleda. Upravo ti delovi Patagonije, koji su nekoliko puta posećivali autorove knjige i snimali, razgovarali sa ljudima, daju jednu dozu verovatnoće da je zaista moglo to da se desi da Hitler živi još sve do 1962. godine. Autor knjige razmatruje i to da su zapravo Nemci, posle nacisti, posle kraja Drugog svjetskog rata, na indirektan način deo bogatstva koje su sklonili napolje, upumpavali u novu Nemačku i tako na neki način uz Maršalov plan doprinali nemačkom ekonomskom bumu. Postoje nekoliko pitanja i dilema. Ako su sve to pretpostavljali, znale britanske i američke tajne službe, zašto su saveznici ćutali? Drugi svjetski rat je pun tih zagonetki zašto se čutalo. Zašto su saveznici sve do 1945. čutali o holokaustu? Zašto nije bilo ni jedne fotografije, ni jedno aerofoto snimka? Snimali su sve nemačke fabrike u detalje, a nijedan logor smrti u sistemu logora holokausta nisu snimili. Da li su saveznici hteli time što su prihvatili službenu verziju da se Hitler ubio u bunkeru, hteli da omoguće novoj, mladoj, demokratskoj nemačkoj državi da krene u novi život bez hipoteke Adolfa Hitlera i nacizma na svojim plećima? Da li su na taj način od Nemačke stvarali najjačeg svog piona i bastion u hladnom ratu, borbi i konfrontaciji sa Sovjetskim savezom? Autori kažu da je to vrlo moguće. Zašto su Jevreji ćutali? Da li su znali, nisu znali? Mlada jevrejska država 1948. godine nije imala previše vremena da se brine i bavi samo potragom za nacističkim ratnim zločincima. Bilo je pre svega pitanje oformiti jevrejsku državu. Su Jevreji te godine čak imali kratkotrajni rat sa Britancima koji su držali kompletnu područje Cisjordanije, odnosno Palestini. Dakle, zašto su Rusi ćutali? Ha, Rusi nikad nisu ni baš previše tvrdili da je Adolf Hitler da se ubio u bunkeru. Čak maršal Žukov kaže da trupla, leševi koji su pronađeni pored bunkera, koje su pronašli sovjetski vojnici, po svemu sudeći, ne odgovaraju ostacima Hitlera i Eve Braun. Dwight Eisenhower je rekao da sve pretpostavke govore da je Hitler mrtav, ali da nema ni najmanjeg dokaza za to. Stalin nikada nije poverovao da je Hitler skončao svoj život u bunkeru.
Prošlo je skoro 7 decenija od kada je završen Drugi svetski rat, a on i dalje fascinira i obuzima pažnju javnosti zbog razno raznih razloga, između ostalog i zbog toga što je taj rat u mnogome uticao na to kako danas živimo. Zatim tu je naravno lik i delo Adolfa Hitlera kao velika fascinacija, a mogao bi se tu pomenuti i možda najveći pisac, američki pisac 20. veka, Kurt Vonnegut, koji je na svoj satiričan način rekao da će Drugi svjetski rat ostati upamćen u istoriji čovečanstva prevashodno i najviše zbog kroja nacističkih uniformi. Dokaz da ta fascinacija traje i danas jeste izuzetno veliki uspeh knjige Sivi vuk, bekstvo Adolfa Hitlera, koju sam imao zadovoljstvo da prevedem za izdavačku kuću Admiral Books. I postoje takve knjige koje kad uzmete u rad i kad počnete da ih prevodite, istog trenutka znate da će biti izvanredan hit na književnom tržištu i ova knjiga je upravo takva. Autori u knjizi objašnjavaju i to kako je Hitler imao pomoć međunarodne obaveštajne zajednice i nekih organizacija kao što je Katolička crkva i Međunarodni crveni krst, nažalost, i uspeo da izvede taj veliki mađioničarski trik i da tobože počini samoubistvo u bunkeru u Berlinu 45. Zapravo da pobegne u Argentinu, gde je sve bilo spremno, gde je sve bilo već pripremano od 1943. kada su nacistička kola krenula nizbrdo, da se obezbede i udome nacističke glavešine. Sam njegov put, bekstvo i tako dalje, možda i nije toliko zaprepašćujući koliko otkrovenja vezana za to kako zapravo međunarodna politika funkcioniše, kako je funkcionisalo to vreme, a i boga mi kako funkcioniše i dan danas. Meni je recimo isto tako bio izuzetno interesantan moment, odnosno odnos između nacista i režima Juana Perona i Evite Peron u Argentini. To kako je Evita bila nacistički agent još i pre nego što se upoznala sa Peronom i kako su zapravo Peronovi iskoristili ogroman deo tog opljačkanog blaga koje su nacisti prebacili kroz 900 paravan kompanija u Južnu Ameriku da bi osnažili svoj režim i da bi zapravo oni opljačkali naciste. Posleratna istorija u Južnoj Americi pokazuje da zaista ova knjiga i tvrdnje koje su autori izneli u njoj imaju izuzetno osnova. Možda je to revizija istorije, možda je to zapravo prvi put da velika istina izlazi na videlo. To je na čitaocu da proceni. Ja moram da kažem da su mene autori ubedili, a pritom bih posebno napomenuo izjavu jednog od današnjih političara u Argentini, koji je, kada su ga autori upitali da li je tačno da je Hitler zajedno sa svojim saradnicima pobegao 45. u Argentinu i tu živeo sve do svoje smrti 1962. izjavio, 40. godine u Argentini sve bilo moguće.